वीडियो देख रहे सभी साथियों को मेरा नमस्कार। माय नेम इज़ आकाश एंड आई एम प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन सिंस लास्ट 2 इयर्स। आई विद माय फ्यू फ्रेंड्स वी डिसाइडेड टू लॉन्च वन चैनल विच विल बी डेडिकेटेड टूवर्ड्स द प्रिपरेशन ऑफ यूपीएससीज सिविल सर्विसेज एग्जामिनेशन विच विल प्रोवाइड फ्री गाइडेंस टू दो स्टूडेंट हु आर not privileged enough to join any coaching classes. So here we will be providing you the free guidance for the prelims, mains and all other optional subjects. This very first video of mine will be dealing with India-Nepal's relations. So here we are starting with it. So why India-Nepal relation is in current now, what's hot about it? Recently Nepal's new political map is released in which they incorporated the disputed Kalapani, Limpuya Adhura and Lipu Lake, which India claims to be its territory. So Nepal on 5th of May, I'm not sure about the date, but Nepal released its new political map in which they incorporated the disputed region of Kalapani, Limpuya Adhura and Lipu Lake, which India claims that these territory are India's territory. So here we will be analyzing what this dispute really is. We are going to dig up to the history and we will analyze why Nepal says that these disputed regions are Nepal's territory. So here we are talking about the Treaty of Sagoli of 1816, which was signed between the British East India Company and the Nepalese monarchy. This treaty ended the Anglo-Nepalese War, which was waged during the period of 1840 and 1860. So in this treaty, the rearrangement of the territory of Nepal took place and most of the Nepalese region was given to British India. So Nepal took motivation from this treaty and states that Nepal argued that this political map is based on the settlement which was during this treaty. So they basically argued that these disputed region were given to Nepal during this treaty, and thus they asserted that these three regions are the Nepalese integral regions. Nepal further argues that the region of Kalapani, which was integral territory of Nepal, which was given by the King of Nepal to India after 1962 war, which was waged against China for the security purposes, and they again asserted that this settlement was temporary settlement and this region of Kalapani was not given permanently to the India. Moving forward, so India responded, means how India responded to this new political settlement of Nepal. India termed this settlement as artificial and India refused to accept the new political map of Nepal, and India invited Nepal to talk over the issue. So the circled region, you can see the circled region, the red circled region is the disputed region which extends from Limpuya Adhura to Kalapani. We are on our main course, the India-Nepal relations. While analyzing the India-Nepal relations, we need to know the historical development which shaped the current course of India-Nepal relations. While discussing about the relations between India and Nepal, we need to know about the historical development, and historical development, not the bilateral historical development, but also the Nepalese internal political development, because the history of Nepalese politics is so unpleasant and is
prime example of political instability. So Nepal need to fought a long war to be Republican state. So now we will be discussing the internal political system of Nepal. So here we are having insight into the Nepal's internal politics. During medieval period, Nepal was divided into many fragments, and it was divided as in many kingdoms. So the Gorkha ruler Prithvi Narayan Shah conquered Kathmandu and laid the foundation of unified kingdom of Nepal in 1768. Another development is Anglo-Nepalese War of 1814 and 1816, which decided the Nepal's current territorial boundaries. In 1846, Jang Bahadur Rana took over as a prime minister and established the hereditary rule of Ranas as prime minister, which lasted for another 104 years. The Shah Kings, which was the monarchy, was reduced to figurehead with no authority. So here basically the Jang Bahadur Rana took over all the powers from the monarchy and vested himself with the sole authority. And during this period, Nepal was kind of the autocratic state. And during the reign of Ranas, the Indo-Nepal Treaty of 1950 signed. We will be discussing about that treaty in the further slides. So, another political development and another landmark development is the emergence of Nepal Congress Party, which was formed in 1946 and thus started the anti-Ranas movement. With the emergence of Nepal political party came the idea of republicanism, parliamentarianism, and democracy. In 1950, the hereditary monarch King Tribhuvan, along with other anti-Rana forces, formed an alliance, and they tried to overthrow the Ranas. And in 1951, the Ranas rulers, the rule of Ranas ended, and the King Tribhuvan was restored to the throne, and the monarchy was once again became an important center of power in Nepal. King Tribhuvan was succeeded by the King Mahendra in 1955. In 19 re, sorry, read it as 1959. In 1959, multi-party constitution was adopted, and first general election were held. Nepali Congress Party won with absolute monarchy. Then King Mahendra seized the control and suspended parliament, constitution, and party politics. He banned all the political parties after Nepali Congress Party's win in election, with the BP Koirala as premier in 1960. Then King introduced the panchayat system with sole authority with himself. So basically, this was attempt of King overthrowing the democratically elected government, which again established the autocratic government of the monarchy. So after this incident, with the expiration of trade and transit treaty, which was signed between India and Nepal, there arose trade and transit dispute, which led to economic blockade by India in 1989. So this was the major incident. Then, with the pro-democratic agitation coordinated by Nepalese Congress Party and the leftist groups in 1990, King Birendra agreed for new democratic constitution, and Nepali Congress Party won the 1991 elections under Girija Prasad Koirala, or GP Koirala. And in 1949, Koirala government failed and communist government formed, and subsequently in 1959, the communist government was dissolved. So you can trace the political instability, which is basically the tussle between the monarchy, democracy, and communism. Moving forward, 1995 onward, Nepal witnessed Maoist revolt, which wanted to abolish monarchy, and there was continuous political instability after 1955 because of the Maoist insurgencies. In 2001, Nepal declared state emergency in wake of Maoist revolts, and in the same year, witness the palace massacre. In this palace massacre, the king along with the members of royal family was killed by the prince of royal family, and then after this incident he shot himself as well. And then after this incident, the king Ganendra took over the throne. In 2003, after 7 months of clash between the Maoist rebels and government, the ceasefire was declared. Then King Ganendra restored absolute monarchy and dismissed democratic government on 2005, citing the need to defeat Maoist rebels and imposed state emergency. After international pressure in 2005, King lifted emergency and again he reinstalled the parliament. So you can trace the conflict between the democracy and monarchy in the Nepal. In 2006, parliament unanimously curbed all the powers of king and held peace talks with the Maoists, because Maoists wanted to overthrow the monarchy. The talks with Maoists resulted into the Comprehensive Peace Agreement of 2006. And during this period, the Maoist insurgencies was keep on, and in 2007 there was bombard on Kathmandu, and the parliament then totally abolished the monarchy, and then the Maoist, sorry for the spelling mistake, the Maoist joined the government. In 2008, Nepal became republic officially, and the issue of the constitution was yet to resolve, because there were some issues with the Madheshis and the hill regions. But in 2015, the parliament of Nepal passed landmark constitution. So this was the historical political development of Nepal. Exam point of view, these things are not important, but I just for your information, I just mentioned this political development of Nepal. So now we will talk about the India-Nepal relations. So we will go into the historical development of the India-Nepal relations. The very important treaty which was signed between India and Nepal is the India-Nepal Treaty of Peace and Friendship, which was signed in 1950. So it was signed between the Ranas of Nepal, which was not politically elected institution, and Indian ambassador to Nepal. Some things which are mentioned in this treaty are the peace, sovereignty, territorial integrity and independence. It means that both countries will commit themselves to peace, they will recognize the sovereignty of each other, they will protect the territorial integrity of each other and independence. The government of Nepal shall be free to import, form or through the territory of India, arms, ammunition or warlike material and equipment necessary for the security of Nepal. National treatment for each other's citizen in industrial and economic development, and some privileges in the matters of residence, ownership of property, participation in trade and commerce, movement and other privileges of a similar nature. It permitted the free movement of both the country's nationals and gave right to settle down. So there was a separate provision which was related with supplies of arms. Here it is mentioned that Nepal should buy arms from India and can buy from any third country only if India fails to meet the demand after informing India. So moving forward, now the state of Nepal advocates that there is need to revisit the treaty which was signed in 1950. They want to revise the treaty and they want to eliminate some of the provisions or add some of the provisions, and India is too ready for this, but not altering the basic tenets of the treaty. So why Nepal wants to revise the treaty? The very fundamental argument of Nepal is that the treaty is unequal. They argue that this treaty is basically in favor of India, and Nepal will not get much from it. And another argument is that that this treaty was signed with the Ranas, who were not elected, and they were not the will of the people. And another argument is that the Nepalese law does not permit an open border, and Indians by law should not be able to buy land and properties in Nepal or carry out businesses in their name. So these are the basic arguments which Nepal gives in favor of revising the treaty. And India too wants to revise the treaty, but without altering the basic tenets of the treaty. So we will continue this lecture in the part 2. and please subscribe to the channel UPSC Talk, share it with your friends, and comment below what more topics you need in these international relations section. Thank you so much. Jai Hind.